शिवाय, ओम नमः शिवाय, ओम नमः शिवाय, ओम नमः शिवाय,
ओम नमः शिवाय, ओम नमः शिवाय, ओम नमः शिवाय, ओम नमः शिवाय,
ओम नमः शिवाय, ओम नमः शिवाय, ओम नमः शिवाय, ओम नमः शिवाय,
ओम नमः शिवाय,
शिवाय, ओम नमः शिवाय, ओम नमः शिवाय, ओम नमः शिवाय,
ओम नमः शिवाय, ओम नमः शिवाय, ओम नमः शिवाय,
ओम नमः नारायणाय, ओम नमो नारायणाय, ओम नमो कंटिन्यू द सब्जेक्ट विद विच वी कंप्लीटेड आवर सेशन ड्यूरिंग लास्ट संडे. ए जनरल क्लैश दैट ऑफन टेक्स प्लेस between socio-personal values and spiritual values may land a person many a time in a mood of despondency, melancholy and despair. The clash is between these values which are open to the human individual, in which everyone is sunk up to the neck and regards these values as absolute in themselves, believing in nothing more than what is agreeable to the mind and the reason controlled by the sense organs. What are personal values and what are social values and what are spiritual values, between which there is a conflict leading to untoward consequences in one's daily life. The values that a person holds as final, absolutely necessary and inseparable from one's own self may be regarded as personal values, the authority that one exercises while affirming oneself in a don't care manner, when it comes to that, the personal ego is threatened. As long as the egoistic personality is pampered, worshipped and adored, it looks like a golden temple, most attractive and beautiful. But the characteristic of the ego is intolerance of opposition. There is a peculiarity about this trait in every human individual. What I say is right, and what anybody else says is wrong. This is the affirmation of egoism. And apart from egoistic values, sometimes getting mixed up with so-called rationalization of values, emotional values, there are purely values of sensory appreciation. To which a person will cling up to the point of death for the sake of the honor of the ego, for the purpose of maintaining what is regarded as self-respect, one will be prepared to lose one's life. And similarly, sense-ridden passions may land a person in considering his or her life as worthless when those passions are not fulfilled. Egoistic values and sensory values are the principal values which the personality clings to. Everything is judged in terms of these evaluations of person. Social values are the well-known do's and don'ts of life. Do this, don't do that. Everywhere you hear these things being told. These do's and don'ts vary from country to country, from culture to culture. The do's of one country may not be the do's of another country, and so also are the don'ts. So they are galvanized by the ethnic, anthropological and geographical influence exerted upon people, so that these do's and don'ts are not absolute. Yet a particular culture, particular society regards them as absolute. When it is said that it should be done and it should not be done, it is permanent dictum discharged by society for the fulfillment and obedience of every individual in that community or society. That is why often people who are tethered vehemently by certain cliches of these kinds of restrictions in a particular society abandon their society and go to another society, enter another country with another sense of values and many things which may, from the point of view of that individual at least, offer opportunities of greater freedom and facility of expression. These are modern as well as ancient. while social values change from time to time, from ancient time to medieval age and from medieval age to modern times, and due to exigencies of certain circumstances in society, yesterday's social values may be turned down for the sake of a newly engendered value today, but personal values do not change. A person cannot change the egoism of oneself, even in centuries. Similar is the value attached to sensory attractions. Hemmed in from all sides by these operations within as well as without, human nature, when it seeks to confront what are known as spiritual or divine values, it faces a dark curtain in front, a thick wall against which it can knock its head and fall down. The values that are known as spiritual are difficult to understand. They do not consist in study of scriptures, frequenting temples, rolling of beads, fasts and vigils. None of these can be regarded as ultimately what we mean by spiritual values. A thing that liberates a person from bondage of mortality, that alone can be regarded as a spiritual value. Let anyone cogitate for oneself whether these external manipulations, performances and rituals which go by the name of religion can lead one to immortal existence. If in the heart of hearts one feels that nothing of this kind can lead to immortality, the religion of society falls as a savior of humanity. What then is spiritual value? Briefly, as I mentioned, it is that outlook of life, that adoption of behavior, that consideration of one's circumstance and environment which will fit into the nature of the working of nature taken as a whole and not in parts. Even cultural values differing from one country to another country cannot be regarded as spiritual values, because they vary from one circumstance to another circumstance. Nature has no country. It has no class or clan. It has no language. It does not speak in a human tongue, though we may say every leaf in a tree speaks in its own way, a language known to itself only. The operations of nature, the universe as a whole, are totally different in character and modus operandi from the methods we employ in our day-to-day existence in this world. Nature has no respect for individuality. Whether it is a man or a woman, whether one is a rich or a poor one, Nature has no such considerations. Its values are totally different from humanly conceived social values. If someone dies in a family, a great tragedy is said to befall that particular family. But if millions die, it is not a loss to nature. If one child is born, it is rejoicing in heaven for the family in this world. If millions are born, it is nothing to nature. Because the workings of nature are based on what we may call a total visualization of value. The whole thing is taken into consideration at the same time, while nature opens its eyes and works its ways through the process of evolution. But no human being can think in a total fashion. Our method of mental operation is mostly personal, artificially family oriented. And if it is extended further into society and the like, it is again a diluted form of personal affirmation. All social values are actually extended forms of personal values. There is no such thing as society except a large body of individuals operating in a given manner. We speak of society. It is impossible to conceive its existence independent of the individual constituents of which it is made. An arrangement or a pattern of the operation of certain classes of individuals is called society for the time being. And societies vary as cultures vary in different countries. So these modes of working in life by the human nature also vary accordingly. The way in which nature works is also the way in which God works. Nature is the face of God. And if you cannot know how God works, you have only to observe how nature works. But ridden as we are to the limited vision of personality and personality-oriented society, we cannot even find time to be impartial enough to probe into the mysteries of nature. What is nature? It is a total of phenomena. All things and everything put together, not in a slipshod manner, but in a harmonious way, so that the whole universe forms an organism, a living individual. Nature is a living body, and it is one body only. You cannot have many natures, many universes, and all that. Since nature is one and it is a living entity as a single organism, its ways are really the ways that finally succeed. And no other boasting of man in any manner whatsoever will work, and no use wagging one's tail before nature's laws. It can topple down stars, suns and moons down when it doesn't want them. It can dry up oceans, create droughts and floods, epidemics, wars and destructions. Anything of that kind may be sanctioned by the vision of nature, from the point of view of its end, which is always escaping the notice of human perception. The whole of nature has a particular aim before it, and it relentlessly pursues that aim, and everyone has to follow the track followed by nature. It is like the vehicles attached to a railway engine following the track followed by the engine. They cannot have another track. If any individual is harsh and audacious enough to assert his or her own ambitious path of personal glorification and sensory gratification, nature will give a kick to that individual in the form of disease, aberration, bereavement, and finally death itself. Actually, what we call death is only a nemesis that follows from the reactions nature sets up against violations by the individual of its own laws. There is no such thing as an individual body in nature taken as a whole. There are no personalities. There is no humanity, no creation as we think it to be. This, if it could be properly understood even by the stretch of our imagination, we may be stepping on the first footstool of a spiritual view of things. Any kind of external performance and demonstration externally is not going to be regarded as worth a fig by the law of nature. We can deceive anybody, but nobody can deceive nature. It will penalize a person who goes against its principles. Unfortunately, everyone goes against natural laws. By natural law, I do not mean merely breathing fresh air, eating good food, drinking cow's milk, and doing daily exercise. I do not mean these as natural laws, though they also form part of it. Natural law is the vision of life, which is the vision entertained by nature itself. It is hard, of course, to conceive what nature is. For that, I gave an illustration to you. The farthest reach of the human mind includes the boundary of nature. You can imagine how far, to what distance your mind can travel. It can reach the stars. It can go beyond the galaxies. It can touch the boundaries of space and time. All that is within nature. So vast is the concept that we can have if we are to meditate on the principle of natural workings. When the attempt at this kind of thinking succeeds even a little bit, a tremendous transformation will take place inside oneself as well as in the atmosphere outside oneself. Because nature includes oneself as also what is outside oneself. So anyone who believes in the law of nature thinks, behaves and acts to the extent possible according to the law of nature will transform the individual as nature would deem it proper, and transform also the circumstances or the environments of the individual, because environment goes together with the individual. We are made up of environment also, and not merely by your bodily frame. an effort of a varied nature, unthinkable ordinarily, is necessary to conduct oneself in this manner in one's daily life. For several days we have been discussing these subjects from different angles of vision, but how many can retain these thoughts in the mind? The mind is so tricky as to confirm again and again that sensory and egoistic values are final. And whatever you have heard from elders or from scriptures, they pass over the head of the individual and they do not enter within, as any amount of water poured on a rock will not permeate or enter into the rock. Deep meditation is called for this purpose. You must remember that you have no friend in this world. You should not ignore nature and say, we have got many friends. I can be protected by my own family members. I have got a large army. The army is nowhere before nature. All the powers that you can conceive in this world are like a little bit of husk before natural forces. It can blow a wind, it can throw half of the world out. Such power nature has got. And therefore, boasting too much about one's own capacity and to be too much complacent about one's social and personal achievements is tomfoolery of the first order. Therefore, every seeker, everyone on the path of the spirit, has to guard oneself from the kicks and blows that one may have to receive one day from natural laws. Every minute we have such kicks by problems that we are facing in life. All the problems of life, social, political, economic, whatever they are the conflict arising out of the difference between human way of thinking and natural way of thinking. It is an ungodly way of living that is the cause of all the sorrows of life, whatever be their nature. So merely depending on one's own arms, muscular or industrial, is a futile way of living. Especially people who are little aged, who have grown white hairs and have learned the art of mature thinking, will not fall into the pit of this erroneous thought that the world can save us from the sorrow of mortality. It is a comprehensive approach to life, inclusive of oneself and society and the whole of nature, the entire creation, that is required in thinking. This is what you may call absolute thinking, total thinking, universal thinking, or we may dare to say God thinking. This is true meditation. Any other kind of scratching over the head cannot be a successful meditation at all. In meditation, you touch the core of reality. If you are not even able to approach the borderland of reality and it remains far away from you, the problems remain always problems. The world has remained an abode of sorrows and problems right from its creation, because the world is nothing but an area of action by individuals who contrarily work against nature. Universal thinking is unimaginable to the human level of approach. We are all human beings, no doubt. But how long will we be contented in being only human beings? Because from the biological point of view, we are like animals. And even psychologically, we are not far off from the subhuman level. The only egoism that we have, which is super arrogant, distinguishes us from the category of life which we call in our own egoistic adumbration again from the animal and the plant life, etc., which may be perhaps nearer to reality than the human ego. Thus, seekers, inmates of this ashram, guests and visitors who come here to partake of the blessedness of the vibrations of this place will do good in carrying some treasure which is of permanent value when they go home. And those who are residentials here will carry this wisdom with them permanently forever and ever as a eternal gift that has come from God Himself. What can be a greater gift than the ability to think like this? The greatest gift, the greatest treasure is understanding. Minus that, everything else falls flat in its value. A person without proper understanding always thinks wrongly from egoistic manner and sensorily. That person cannot sit for meditation because secretly there is a voice speaking from inside, guided by the senses, the aesthetic sense and the ego, that life is something different for you than what others speak of. Every saint and sage, every master who has trod on this path had to face these difficulties of spiritual life, where voices were heard from within and also from without, one opposing the other, one phenomenal, another spiritual, actual and nominal. It is up to us, with the utmost effort that we can exercise, to find time to befriend God. Would you lose anything by being a friend of God? You would rather be friends of people who pamper your ego, cajole you, advertise you in the papers and do all kinds of things to fatten the personality which is ego-ridden, than really help you on the right path. Suhrudam sarvabhutanam jnatva mam shantimarichati is a solacing passage from the Bhagavad Gita. Know me to be the friend of all beings and the final friend of you all. When everyone deserts you at the crucial moment of your life, I shall come to you as your real friend, a friend whom you have ignored throughout your life, right from your birth. Now at the time of danger and the utter sorrow of your life, I am here as your real friend, says the great master Bhagavan Sri Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita. Suhradam sarvabhutanam jnatva mam shanti marchati. If you really believe that you cannot trust anybody in this world, finally, anybody can deceive you, and there can be clash among family members. A brother can separate himself from another brother. Wife can cut herself off from her husband. Anything can happen anywhere in human society. Knowing this, whom would you regard as a real friend and a savior of your life? Do you want to go quitting this world with the feeling that you have lost the only opportunity given to you for preparing yourself for an onward march to the realization of reality, in this arduous task, which is so difficult even to imagine in the mind. Many of the things that I have told you in these few minutes, much of it will not remain in your mind when you go out of this hall. Yet, supposing you have entertained them in your mind, the implementation of these ideas in practical life is so hard. Who will help you? There also you have got a great consolation from God Himself. I am with you. Not only I am here as your friend ultimate, I am also a help to you at every step in your movement towards God. This is what we call the avatara or the incarnation of God, which takes place at every critical moment of life. Dharma samsthapanarthaya sambhavami yogi yogi. For the establishment of the righteousness of the law, I incarnate myself at every critical juncture of life. This is the great consolation again by the most compassionate Almighty, dearer to us than mothers and fathers. The incarnation comes to our aid as a kind of brilliant illumination, a flash of light on the path of yoga. Darkness gets dispelled, doubts are cleared automatically by your own self without any external aid, because an incarnation is operating inside. Nobody can help you except God, and He operates within as well as without. Without as the ultimate goal for your salvation of spirit, within as your perpetual guide and friend. Sunk as we are in the values that are purely materialistic and mortal, accustomed as we are to value these visible comforts of life alone as final, we cannot take seriously into heart these admonitions of the spirit and the glories of the spiritual path. Repeated practice is necessary. Abhyasa vairagya abhyam tannirodha. Repeated practice, daily sessions of meditation are necessary, and intensity of aspiration for liberation of spirit is also called for. Tivra samveganam asannaha. Easy it is to approach it, provided your heart wells up in an ardor and an eagerness which you alone can explain. The ardor, the eagerness with which a mother would jump into the well to save a drowning child. The ardor, the eagerness with which a millionaire will hug his wealth. An ardor and longing with which one clings to egoistic values of self-perpetuation by exercising authority and running for name, fame and power. That these values are no values at all, that they are empty of their content, is difficult to know, because we are perpetually being deceived by the senses. Like a magic show before us, which is delighting to see, but the secret behind which we cannot know. The world is acting like a magician before us, appearing to tempt us with all kinds of presentations and gifts, and finally denying each one of them so that we get nothing from the world. Knowing this, A person should be internally detached and root oneself in deep contemplation on what today I described as a way of thinking as nature herself thinks. A total way of thinking, an organic way of thinking, an absolute thinking, one thinking only, which includes every other kind of thinking. Then you will see the whole world lifted out of its veil and shining before you as the face of Almighty God Himself. You will realize then this external world, which has been tantalizing you for all time, when the veil of space and time are lifted, will be seen as shining gold of the beautiful creation of God Almighty. It will not tempt you, it will not repel you, because you are included in this wondrous creation of God. With these feelings one has to take rigorously, vigorously, with great ardent and longing mumukshutva for spiritual success through meditation, daily to be carried on, individually by oneself, not for a show before society or the public, but for a perennial satisfaction that will automatically generate from one's own self, indescribable in mortal terms. Such is the beauty of the path of yoga, such is the kindness of God, and such is the blessing we have all to be in this auspicious place and to consider and meditate upon these values at this moment. Hari Om Tat Sat.